want to clear out whatever plants that we need to clear out to get ready for the new garden. And considering the soil, we're instead of uprooting everything and hauling it off, we're just going to chop things, get them smaller, and then let them rest where they lay. You're just gonna chop it and just drop it where it is. You do want to pull these ferns out.
Yeah.
And try to get them by their root system because their root system is edible. So these things will take over an area very quickly, and we have a bunch growing over there. You can pop that off.
Wow.
And if I had a knife on me, then I could pull a little skin back, and if you taste it, it would be really astringent. It would make your mouth like dry it out. But if you roast them, they're sweet. Yeah, and you can eat them like dessert. It's like full of water. Yeah, they're like these little things. A lot of things like nitrogen fixers. So Noah, right behind you. This is another cactus. This one I'm going to save. So that is a nitrogen fixer. And if I were to cut that right now, it would send an enormous amount of nitrogen down into the ground. So for whatever plants we're planting, then they're able to get that nitrogen quickly. Anything that we chop and drop, so instead of pulling things out, we're going to just chop it off because most plants, if we're chopping the plant off, something is released through the root system. Nitrogen is one of the main things. Other things are released as well, but one of the main parts is those roots become dwarf roots. It's no longer a living plant. I mean, some things can stay alive and sprout back up for sure. But a lot of them, you cut off the plant, there's no more life force, it's not going to sprout again, and the roots become worm food. So it's really important actually to leave the roots in the ground. Worms will eat them. They, between being worm food and just decomposing it all together,
Mommy, I want to go see the freshies.
So now you're adding to the soil instead of taking something out of it. This winter, so I'll be planting things like, I'll plant mustard greens. I'll plant, no, not mustard greens, turnip greens. I'll plant turnip greens like as a cover crop of sorts. And I'll leave some of those in the ground because it breaks up the soil and helps to aerate the soil. And then I'll leave them in the ground.
Like without pulling the turnips?
I'll leave some in the ground, yeah, to then again become worm food and just add to the soil. So that's one way. Like you can plant certain things that help break up the soil too to aerate the soil.
It's a balance of chopping and dropping.
I think I could just come in and just start to step on it. If I wanted to be really gentle, then I could avoid the kale that's still here from the winter last year. So, there's a bunch of kale planted here, and we're talking about perennial plants. We're really lucky. Warm enough here, and we have the right microclimate to where things like tomatoes can be year-round. Yeah, they can be perennial. And then if we provide enough shade in the summertime, then things like kale and collard greens become perennial. But if we have like a conventional, you know, agricultural setting where everything is just being fried by the sunlight, there's no way that greens can survive. But if they have enough shade, then they can totally survive. And now, like, this is a full sun area in the summertime, but I've let the different plants grow up around it that provide shade. There's passion vine growing around it, there's bidens, Yeah, it has like so much protection that it's able to retain its water because it's had like this nice little nest. It's got like that little plant sweater on, and so it can retain its water and it's not getting fried by the sun. So I can have kale year round. It's cool. We just have to plant accordingly. So this area has been rows, and traditionally in permaculture, there are rows. Remember, like, we're not trying to create straight lines. Like, there are no straight lines in nature. Things are wild and spirally, and things like to grow in circles, and so it gets wild. But I started this in rows just to try to keep it, you know, somewhat orderly, and so people that walk by can recognize things.
Yeah.
But clearly, nature takes over. So this time we're gonna plant in a circle right here. So we're gonna take this area and we're gonna plant a fruit tree in the middle, and then we'll have its little friends around it. And then we might get two done, we'll see. So we have everything chopped and dropped. And as you all know, like, Biden's is highly medicinal, but I've harvested a lot of Biden's already this year, and I've made my tinctures with it. And I still have more I could harvest, and so I'm gonna, like, remember we talked about return of surplus? Like, I don't need to harvest all of this. If I wanted to make a profit, I could harvest it all and sell it, or I could, you know, harvest all, tincture it and sell it, but I don't need that. And the soil needs the return of surplus more than I do. So I'm gonna let this lie. There's a bunch of, this is all evening primrose. Chop and drop that too. It produces beautiful flowers in the spring. So I know this will come back. I know it'll come back. Even if I put wood chips on it and I clobber it, it's gonna come back. The vines is gonna come back. Everything is gonna come back. I don't need to fear and hold on to it. Alright, we've got it chopped and dropped. Moving on to step two. And you can see from the chop and drop, like, if we took everything out, you can see where the ground is. And just from all of this extra mass, you know, look at how much higher that is. And obviously it's all going to settle and it's going to start to decompose, but it's building up the soil, like, season after season. You know, that's all going to become soil, so it's just more and more soil, right? More and more nutrients.
Yeah.
We have. We have some seaweed.
And did you harvest this from the future?
Yep. This is from St. Augustine. Are these frogs out in the garden too?
Yeah. Apparently they love it.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
I guess there's plenty of bugs in here to go around.
Yeah, there must be.
So I just put a little bit of seaweed in here, and I'm putting coffee grounds in here now. And then, will somebody grab me that bucket that's behind Michael? Is what helps the plant veg out, meaning the leaves to grow. Nitrogen helps like when you see those really dark, healthy leaves, that's from good nitrogen. Mm-hmm. A lot of times when leaves start to yellow, there can be mineral deficiencies, there can be nitrogen deficiencies. The frogs just hopped out.
Oh.
All right, so everybody, you can take a whiff of this.
Yeah.
So this is a fish ferment. So if you ever eat at Thai restaurants, you get this in your food. Unless you specifically ask for no fish sauce, and then they'll still put it in there anyway.
Yeah, I'm sure.
The more diversity of microorganisms in the soil, the more they're going to gobble up nutrients and then provide them for plants. So then you're going to have really, we don't need traditional fertilizer, you know, I shouldn't say traditional, conventional fertilizers, you know, petroleum-based fertilizers, chemicals. Yeah, I made this. I have other buckets going in the back. Whenever Ken or any of my friends go fishing, they bring me the guts and the heads and the remains. And then it's just fish, it's equal parts fish with brown sugar. That's it. And so you can see that it goes from, this goes from solid fish and heads and tails and guts and everything and brown sugar to soup. That's what the bacteria, so it breaks everything down.
And heads, I would put a pound of brown sugar in there?
Yep.
Okay. And that's it?
No, those just fell in.
Oh, okay.
So the brown sugar like breaks everything down?
That's what kicks off the bacteria.
That's awesome. Okay.
Yeah.
And you just cover the box.
Okay. And then what do you think? So we have mulberry trees up here and we have papaya trees. What should go here? Mulberry or papaya?
Mulberry.
Mulberry?
Yeah, so we can sneak some mulberries on the way in.
I agree. Yeah.
Who is this small berry from a friend or from a seed?
Here, why don't you come over here?
Mm-hmm.
You like getting dirty?
Yeah.
I like it muddy.
It's a nice crisp one. And sticky too.
Dirty and sticky.
That a girl.
Yeah.
There's a fish head.
It smells like a farm. It smells like where I grew up.
Alright, so poor mulberry has really needed to go in the ground in a while. Alright, you want to start putting dirt in now?
So when you loosen roots, it's never good to shake them out then? I see people do different things. Like
before you plant?
Mm-hmm.
It's good to loosen them.
Loosen them.
A little bit.
You just
need to loosen them. So, why would we put a tree here? What would be some benefits?
Full sun.
Shade.
To provide shade? Yeah, like this area gets so much sun in the summertime. It's just like full sun almost all day long right here. And when I plant...
Look, it's my foot!
All right, footprints! The tree is going to remember you forever.
Oh.
Yeah.
What?
Okay,
I can't.
Here, let me clear the slate, and then you can do them again. Let's do this. So when I plant like the seedlings in here in the summertime, it's kind of hard on them at first, and it requires too much water to keep them alive. Because eventually, like all of this grows up around them, and it protects them, and it holds the water in. But at first, it's a little challenging. So if I can get this tree in here. And then we have this tree to provide some shade. It's squishy. Yeah, it's all the squishy soft plants underneath it. Yeah, so this will provide a lot of good shade, which will allow the seedlings to kind of get a head start, and they'll be stronger. They won't require as much water early on in the season.
Are we
going to
give it water?
We are going to give it water, for sure. Okay, so we're also going to mulch around it. So we need more mulch.
Yeah, I'll go.
It's dusting up. Is that okay? Can you see the dust?
So my mom had us all walk around barefoot on her garden before she planted it.
Is that a salamander?
It's like a skank or, you know.
Don't cream. What'd you call me?
Patricia.
I'm coming.
Because they don't break down fast. And you know, oak leaves are kind of cupped and they hold water, so when it rains, the water just kind of sits there and it does not allow to just penetrate, go right in. And they just sit there dry, not breaking down, holding water for a long time. But if they're shredded, then that's different. So these are shredded.
And I see multiple types of wood. Is hard, do you want all hardwood for mulch, or does it not matter?
It doesn't matter. Certain woods aren't ideal.
How do you do this?
What, make the mulch?
Yeah.
There's a big machine that just grinds it all up. When the people go around, see how that branch is almost sitting on that power line right there?
They're friends again.
Yeah, plants need their friends, right? And everything works better with diversity, right? So humans need community, like we need friends, we need the tribe, we need community, and we need diversity. If we have it, then we all operate or cooperate, you know, in a better way, right? So same with plants. They need their friends. Plants don't grow alone. And so going back to the question about weeds, you know, to pull weeds or not to pull the weeds. We have a plant that we're trying to grow and tend and cultivate, and then the weeds are growing all around it. And, you know, people think that the weeds are taking the nutrients from the plants that we're trying to cultivate. Well, at the end of the day, you know, scarcity is not a thing in nature. There, like, nothing is lacking in nature. Everything, you know, if nature is allowed to take its course, then everything just grows and proliferates even more. They're not competing so much. Right? There's not this, I mean, there's competition a little bit, and there's certain trees that put out some toxins to weed out competition. Like that, there's that, but it's not so much. There's not competition. There's enough to go around, and especially if we're tending to the gardens and we're, you know, we're inoculating the gardens, we're putting compost tea back in the soil, we're chopping and dropping, all the nutrients are going back into the soil, then there's going to be enough nutrients to go around for everybody. So we don't really need to think about certain weeds taking nutrients from the plants that we're trying to cultivate, because there's enough to go around for everybody. So, okay, we have our mulberry tree, and we'll put some friends around the mulberry tree. But before we do that, it's important to know that trees and herbaceous plants like different environments, right? So that's why we have the forest and all of the trees and various, you know, growth in there. And then we're talking about the edge. It's more herbaceous plants along the edge, right? That's where all of the berries are. That's where all of the wheat, the grains are. That's where the food is, you know, the food that we like the best, at least. So they have different environments. Trees like a more fungal environment.
Hi.
Herbaceous plants like a more bacterial environment. So I'm going to leave a little bit of room around this mulberry tree. I'm going to leave like a little ring of mulch around the mulberry tree, so that as it grows older, we can continue to put branches underneath it, logs underneath it, because that's going to give more carbon to the tree. I'm going to leave a little ring so it can have more wood around it, and that provides more of a fungal environment, and it's going to give it more carbon. And then I'm going to put the herbaceous plants more around it. So when we're designing this, we have our pathway here, right? And then we'll leave a little ring of mulch around the tree, but then we can plant, we can have like a little offshoot going here. So we can plant like over here in this direction. And then we could leave a pathway. And so to show you what I mean, we'll get out some plants. So let's see.
Yeah, you found some mushrooms.
So, let's see. All right, the mulberry tree is there.
It sure can.
All right, see, she's inoculating it.
Good job.
Nice.
Now those kind of mushrooms will grow here. It's dropping all of its little babies right now. A roselle there and a roselle here. Okay. And then we'll have a row of, we'll have a little kind of mulch right here. So that way, whatever I plant here, I can tend to it from over here and from over here. And then I'll plant another row. I'll leave some space for a pathway, and then I'll plant another row right here. So these are gonna kind of be like flower petals coming out with rows in between them. Does that make sense?
Okay. Yes.
Can we get some more mulch coming?
Yeah. Why does the hay need a house?
I don't know. It's a good question.
Maybe it doesn't need a house, it's just in that house. Right?
I think we need, yeah.
She said this was part of her old chicken coop.
Oh.
Maybe it's just like an easy way to store.
I thought Hay House was just a publishing company.
Well, now you know. And this is one of the petals coming off. So where the petals are where we're going to be planting things, this is where the hay is going to go. Right, so I know I have a distinction of, okay, this is my pathway, and this is where I'm cultivating, right?
So you don't need wood chips there?
No, I mean, I could put them down if I wanted to, but we have there's that color distinction, and really, I should be throwing seeds down right now, actually, I'm going to say. We'll do that on the next one.
And what does the hay
start
do?
Getting ahead of myself. It's mulch.
It's mulch? Okay.
Yeah, throw it down. Sprinkle it in. Because it'll all settle. And we want to cover up everything that we just chopped and dropped. To shake it out. So that water can get through, and if I had seeds underneath it, then so that they would be able to sprout. Okay.
So do you not put hay over the mulch?
No. This pile of mulch, I'm gonna start filling in this pathway right here, right? So, because this is going to be a pathway.
Oh, between the petals, yeah.
Oh, okay. Wow. All right. Now it's like coming together.
Beautiful. If you're starting with a yard that's like grass,
this is all you have to do.
Put down mulch.
That's all I did. So this entire place was sod.
And you put mulch over
it? I only mulched it.
You mulched it and then just started.
Now, in the back gardens, the back is full of Kugel culture mounds. So the back, like anywhere I would install a garden, I dug out trenches, buried stuff, So the back is a little different, but this is such a huge area, and I did it all myself. And I wasn't about to be digging all the trenches and installing huge little mounds. And so this just mulched it.
Where do I go to do that? Where
do you go?
It'd be different if I was like someone who was going to be there too.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I can totally see.
Oh my god! I don't need to do this. I'm getting them ready for winter, right? So I have some collards here. Collards grow very well. Not all things, you know, it's good to start from seed. But I have some collard greens, and I'm just going to sprinkle them right on what we chopped and dropped. Collard greens are there. I'm gonna take some of this hay that Luna has broken up for us so beautifully. Beautifully, that's perfect. Now it's perfect for sprinkling right on top of the collard greens. Sprinkle, sprinkle. See, but watch out for this guy. We don't want to sprinkle on top of that one. So we're going to sprinkle the hay over the collard green seeds. So that way, it's kind of like, you know, typically we plant a seed in the dirt and then we put dirt on top of it. Sprinkle, sprinkle! We would put dirt on top of it, right? And then we water it. And then the sunlight, you know, the heat penetrates it, the water, and it starts to germinate, and then the plant pops through. Well, here, instead of putting dirt on top of the seeds, where again the sunlight can come and sterilize the dirt, we're just putting hay on top. We're gonna water it, and it'll get moisture, it'll start to germinate, and it'll pop through the hay. So, and then that's adding, the hay is adding more carbon back in. And that's just going to add to the soil. Thank you. Let's see, got mulch? We're going to have a row here, and then the rows are going to radiate around the tree. Okay?
Yeah.
And so I have the seeds down, I have the hay on top of the seeds, and then now I'll come and I'll pick a spot. And I'll just open up a little spot in the hay, and then I'll put my Roselle down here.
Where you just planted collard seeds.
Yeah. Yeah, so I sprinkled the seed down, and then the hay, and now whatever plant I actually have that's potted, or that's already started, now I'll just create a little opening and put it in. And if there's any collards that, you know, maybe get too close to it when they start growing, if I want to weed them out then I can just pop them out later.
And would you pop them out and replant them somewhere?
I usually don't. And no, I would chop and drop them.
Okay.
These are seeds. Yes. Those are the seeds.
I don't need them.
But we're not going to put them down just yet. Tea.
It's La Jamaica.
Hand me that bucket of compost.
It's biscuits tea.
Hibiscus.
So cute.
Biscuits tea.
Biscuits tea.
So this hot is biscuits. Full of earthworms and like all of this is old. This is all old egg kitchen jelly. Scraps that the earthworms have turned into this. And fun facts, if you weren't aware of this about earthworms, they have gizzards. So they actually have to eat grit. They have to eat like small rocks or eggshells. So the earthworms actually eat the eggshells. They have to have something like this. So these are eggshells that they haven't quite gotten to yet. And all of that's gonna go in there too. All right, let's put it in here. Can you put it? Perfect. There's one.
gonna be the most beautiful video ever.
I know.
Seriously.
It's a little baby. It's like your age. One more roselle for this row.
And you're just digging the soil with your hand for those smaller ones?
Say that again.
You're just digging the soil with your hand for the smaller ones? You're making the holes with your hand?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's kind of cool because...
And how do we know that roselles are... I mean, I know you know, but like how... Should we check to see if roselle is a good accompaniment to like collards if we had an idea to do something before starting?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, and I've planted a lot of things. Just, I've done so much by trial and error.
Yeah.
You can research it.
Text you.
And like search what, like roselle and
accompaniment.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like companion planting charts. And you can see, like, if you Google companion planting, roselle isn't a common crop.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, you find, like, tomatoes and carrots and stuff like that.
And marigolds.
So, there you go.
Yeah, right, and flowers. Yeah.
Just put them right down here.
Yeah, but
roses and garlic. But you don't hear about, like, roselle or the Mayan spinach.
Right.
Is it Aztec or Mayan?
But you could Google companion planting
collards.
Okay.
And then there will be a chart that will tell you.
Look that way!
Ooh, that's a cute, easy one.
Nice.
It'll tell you what's good to plant around them, what's beneficial. Ooh. It'll also tell you what they don't do well around.
Okay.
That's scary. It's moving away.
Wow, there's a bunch in there, huh?
Okay, so we have another little here.
A little mommy
worm. Oh,
a mommy worm with her babies.
I'll leave the Mexican petunias here for now.
So are you gonna hay that part or mulch that part?
So I have the hay here.
Uh-huh. Oh, there's the mulch.
This is the pathway. I actually need to make the pathway thicker. So this is going to be another garden, which is going
to
get
hay.
Okay.
I'm so excited, too.
Does anybody want to put seeds down?
Do it.
I do.
So, go.
Luna,
go,
Chiha.
Go, Chiha.
Okay.
It's very important.
Yeah.
It keeps the water, so it's like a nice balance of everything.
Fluffy.
And
fluffy.
And then also for when the seed germinates,
so it has room.
If it's like a mat of hay, obviously it can't penetrate through. But if it's nice and fluffy, it's got plenty of places to penetrate through and grow up. Isn't centered in the middle, like between the sidewalk and the house, but that's where the opening was, so that's where it went. So for the next one that I plant, I'm gonna plant another mulberry right here. And then, so this pathway is gonna go here, you know, and then we have this circular area of just mulch, so you can walk around the mulberry tree. And you can walk down the path to tend to whatever you're growing. And then the path is going to continue. But instead of just going straight, I think this path is going to
curve.
Kind of curve a little bit. And then so I can have a full circle around that one, like more in the middle. But anyway, so the path will continue to go.
It's so good.
It's how it works when you're in the flow.